Hi, I'm Steve. Welcome back to the Maker's Cave. And as you can see, we are not in the Maker's Cave today. We are on the bridge of the most iconic starship in the galaxy, the USS Enterprise 1701D. And the reason we're starting off today's video here is because we got package one of the Eagle Moss 1701 model build. Again, like all the other model builds, it's going to take a little over a year to build. And we're going to have some fun doing some modifications along the way. So let's leave here and go back to the cave, and we'll start the build. Transporter room, I'm ready for site-to-site transport. And here we are back in the cave, and we're gonna jump right into this. And I already opened this box that they sent me. This is just the first two stages that are in here. So as usual, go over the paperwork. As a matter of fact, I might even move this out of the way because so you can see. Okay, we'll go over the paperwork real quick. This is an IOU from Eagle Moss. Apparently I am supposed to get, we're sorry to inform you that your USS Enterprise 1701D pre-order pin badges gift is currently on back order. So they're just basically saying I will eventually get these. The next thing we have is, which everybody's interested in, which Eagle Moss does with all their models, is the life-size picture of the model. And I knew it was going to be big, but I really didn't think it was going to be this humongous.
They said it was big, but I didn't expect it to be big.
That's pretty big. All right, see, there's the saucer section. There's my hand. According to this, it is 70 centimeters long, which I'd like to say I know my metric and it's 28 inches and I'm a genius with that. But no, I looked it up beforehand. So that's going to be pretty big. Next, we have an information booklet, which Eagle Moss includes in all their models. As a matter of fact, in each shipment, it gives you a little background on either the show or the prop we're building. And this this goes over how they designed and came with the working model for the production and how they also came up with the model. And then last but not least is, of course, the instruction booklet. They call these stages, it's stage one and stage two. They usually only include two issues or two stages in the first shipment. And that's what we'll pull out next. Now, I did some research while I was waiting for this, because this was delayed a little bit. I guess they had some production issues. Everyone seems to want to beat up on Eagle Moss for slow shipping or skipped months. But you know what? It's a niche market. Wonderful models. If I gotta wait a little longer, I mean, heck, you're already waiting 2 years to put this thing together. What's another couple weeks? But there's a gentleman out there who does the Eleanor, Back to the Future, the Ecto. He's doing the Enterprise D now. I believe his name is Todd McWilliams. I should have looked that up beforehand. I didn't. So if I'm messing your name up there, Todd, I apologize. But even in these first two issues, as wonderful as these are, die-cast metal, everything, he did find some discrepancies between how they're building the model and how the production model looks that they use for the show. I guess if you don't feel like going through any of the mods to make it look like the production model, you certainly don't. So any of the mods we're doing here, you don't have to. You can just build the thing and enjoy it. But one of the things he did point out that it didn't get under my skin at first and then it did was the cell, which is stage two. So we'll show you that first. All metal, but there are blue stripes on the side. I'm sure you've seen this on Star Trek, that when they go into warp or when the cells are powered up, I don't know if you can see that, but they're a translucent blue. They light up blue. But what Todd found out was or he looked, that when the nacelles aren't fired up, they're a copper color. And you can see this. I went back, looked at a couple of the shows, and yeah, when the vehicle's sitting idle without any power, these are copper. So basically, you want these to be copper when out the light's on, and then when the light comes on, you want them to go blue. Well, I think he said he tried like seven different ways to get this done, and the final method he came up with is you soak all these blue parts in alcohol, and that removes the blue paint off here, so you would end up with something that's clear. Then once it's clear, you take he used a Tamiya clear blue, which I'm going to use, and he shot the back of the pieces with the translucent clear blue, and then he took 1/64 inch masking tape, paint masking tape, and there's ridges in here, and he put those in all the ridges, and then he shot the side you're going to look at very lightly with Tamiya copper. And I got to admit, it looks pretty impressive. I wasn't going to go through all that, but after I've seen how the ship really looks on screen and how his came out, I'm going to give it a shot. You know, devil hates a coward. I hope I don't screw it up. There's those two pieces there. There's also a rear piece that has to be done like that. And there's also, I already started a test piece over here. There's a little formation light, little tiny light that's blue. But again, in the production models, it's white. So I actually soaked it in alcohol, and in about an hour, all the blue paint came off. So that one's already done. The other thing he pointed out on the nacelle was right here at the end. You'll see all these close-ups when we're building it. This is a translucent amber. And again, when the model's lit up, this lights up. Problem is, in the production model, this didn't light up. It was a static color, like basically a flat yellow color. Luckily, Tamiya makes a flat yellow. So again, what Todd did is he just took this, he painted the whole thing black so the light wouldn't come through, and then he painted flat yellow on top of it. Again, I think we're gonna try that, and that's gonna be interesting because he used an airbrush. And as much as I do making of props or anything else, I've never really used an airbrush before. I've got one back here; it's been sitting here for a couple months. So we're actually going to try using my airbrush with this. So this could be interesting. Now let's move on to decks 1 and 2 that are included. And this is the stage one, they call it, which of course, you know, includes some wiring, because you're actually going to put some LEDs in with this build right off the bat, unlike the DeLorean where you have to be 50 issues in before you get to it. The of course, the obligatory free screwdriver that is magnetized. And one of the biggest things he found is, let's go to deck 2 here. There's little cutouts here for windows, and this piece goes in here, and again, you'll see this when we put this in. Some of them are blacked out. Here's the problem that he discovered. Actually, he picked it out before even putting it together. He was concerned about it. Is the paint that they have on some of these windows that they want to be dark, the paint doesn't go all the way down. So what happens is you get light leaks. So you get these weird looking frames, light frames around windows that are supposed to be dark. So what we're going to do is, we're on the bottom here, we're going to take some black paint, and we're actually going to make sure no light goes up into there to complete that. The other thing that he found, damn his detail, this is the bridge deck, very small. You're probably not even going to be able to see it, but right here there's a small circular molded out piece. It's about maybe eighth of an inch, maybe that 3/16, about that. The problem is in the, again, in the production model that you see on screen, there's a clear dome here and it lights up. This does not. So we're going to be drilling a hole in here, and then using a clear filament on the 3D printer, we're going to create a clear dome over here to put on top here, and it'll actually get lit by the lights that light up the rest of this saucer section. Todd used a series of epoxy that he just kept layering on top to make a dome. I don't trust my skills with that, so I'm just going to go with the 3D printer and do it that way. And as far as that stage, I think that's all the modification. Oh, let's go back to deck two. There are two. Again, you'll see this in detail when we get up to it. But right on the side here, there's two ports. I forget what they are for right now. I'll tell you later when we build. But they're actually painted a flat red. Actually, no, I think it's a glossy red. But they're supposed to be red in the production model. So we're going to mask this off, and we're going to paint these two things red. And I forgot another important thing that he found out, which I don't know why Eagle Moss did this. But right here, there are emergency flush vents. I guess when they flush plasma or whatever the script calls for. But one side gets a black insert, and the other gets a clear that lights up when the vehicle's lit up. I don't know why you would want these flush ports to light up. They certainly don't light up on a production model. I don't think they, and you know, why would you just have one side lit up and not the other? So what Todd did, and the same thing I'm going to do, is we're going to take those pieces and we're going to paint them a very close color to what this hole is, and then we're going to put them in here, and they are not going to light up. They're just going to be a static color in there. I think it's more realistic. You know, usually we add lights to things. This model here with these, we're actually going to take lights away. So what we're going to do now, as usual, we're going to bring you up close and we'll start putting this together.
After looking at how long the mods and the assembly took, I decided to split this into two videos. This is going to be the assembly and mods, or rather the mods first, then the assembly of stage one, and then I'll have another video with the mods and assembly of stage two. I think that'll be a lot easier for you guys to sit through, and it won't be as long. So let's get back to it. If you've seen any of my other videos for the model build, you know the first thing I do is I get our little custom screw holder here, because these Eagle Moss models come with a variety of screws, so you want to keep them all straight. So the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to go through each package, and I'm going to take the screws out. Out of stage one. And here's stage two. I've got my X-Acto, and I've got our Sharpie, so we can write down what these are. Okay, all the screws are in their proper place. Put this up here. I'm really excited to get started on this. I've been waiting a long time for this. Okay, we're gonna start with stage one. We're gonna be putting a hole right in this top section where the bridge is, so we can put that dome piece in. We're gonna 3D print. As you can see, it's about 3.4 mils across. And what I did is to make sure that my drill bit doesn't wander, even though I am using a hand drill or a pin vise, is I took an X-Acto knife, put the point exactly where I need it to be, and I gave it a few turns. And as you can see, it created a little divot right there. So the drill has a good place to start. And I start twisting. Of course, we're going to start small and get progressively bigger with our drill bits so we don't tear out the plastic. So that was the 3 millimeter bit, and once it was done, I wanted it a little bit bigger, so I pulled out the my standard SAE sizes, and I drilled it out with a 1/8 inch bit, and that gave me the hole size I was looking for. And there it is, all finished. As you can see, that's really nice. Stepping up each size of the drill bit gave us a nice clean hole in that bridge. Now it was time to design the dome. This is a simple piece, so there was no need to drag out Fusion 360 for this. I just went over to Tinkercad, used their cylinder feature to create a small cylinder, and then their dome feature to create the dome, and I made it a low dome. I didn't make it a real high dome. And I made it about 1 millimeter wider than the cylinder, so it hung over about a half a mil. And then it was a matter of just exporting it out to the 3D printer. This is a real quick print. It only takes about a minute for this to come out. Here it is, freshly printed. You will notice some stringing at the top, but with your snips, you can take that right off, and you can also sand that a little bit right off, and it's fine.
Okay, here's our bridge. Here is the hole that we drilled out to 1/8 of an inch. And here is the 3D printed part. So all we're going to do is we're going to put that right in here. There you go. There's a dome. So you can see it sits flush. So let's just see how this looks all lit up. So what we're going to do is we're going to put this right on top here and let's light it up. As you can see, the dome lights up real nice. This LED is sitting right underneath this dome piece, so it's really bright. But in when we assemble this, I believe it just gets lit by the ambient light that's underneath that lights up the bridge windows. Okay, we have this clear. Now, I can't remember who it was. I think it was World of Wayne. He actually decided to do amber on his, and he used a Sharpie, a yellow Sharpie. So I think maybe we'll try that. Take the light away for a second. So you can see there where there is some yellow.
I just ended up taking some still shots for you because it was easier for you to see the difference. Here's a picture of it lit and unlit. I really like how this looks. It's going to look cool on the model. And that concludes the bridge dome modifications. This mod, we're going to paint the two umbilical connect points red. Again, that's how they are in a production model. They're real small. They're right here. Look at the size of the blade versus the size of that square. So what we'll do is we'll mask that off so we can paint that. All right, this is where we had a bit of a learning curve and where things started to go wrong. First, I wanted to paint this flat red. I thought I had some. I did not. I only had a gloss red, but I said, you know what, let's just bling this out and we'll make it gloss red. So I pulled out the Tamiya gloss red sacrificial piece of paper. The original plan was to spray paint those ports, but I never used my airbrush before, and the more I thought about it, I turned into Ensign Barkley. I was just too scared to do it. I did the first side and it was fine. Paint laid down real nice, the masking tape worked. And here's where the trouble began. I started to do the other side, just like I did the other side. And I noticed, oh, I'm getting some on the masking, that's good. And then something didn't look right. The paint started to seep under the masking. I didn't have it laid down tight enough. So I had to pull it off to see what kind of damage I had done to the hole. And as you can see, as I pull it off, I basically have a big old, you know, red stain right there covering everything on the hole. So before the paint dried and got away from me, I grabbed a paper towel and dabbed some of that 91% rubbing alcohol on it and went to town, and luckily it came right off. I was lucky. So then I decided I better take a look at the other side and see, make sure I didn't mess up that. And although it wasn't as bad as the other side, I did have a little bit of bleed over. So this is the side that I was really bad. It was that red blob. So I decided, forget the masking. Let me just use the micro brush and paint as best I can, which I did. And it actually came out very nice. Deck 2 umbilical connections painted. Next thing we'll do is those emergency flush vent painting. Here are the two emergency flush vents that we discussed earlier. One is clear, one is black, because one lights up, one does not. We're going to paint them a color that's going to come close to the hole color and take away the lighting so they're not going to light. All right, so it was time for me to put my big boy pants on and try out airbrushing. Paint I'm using is Vallejo Russian Air Force Gray Blue. From building the other Enterprise models, the standard plastic models, I know that the Enterprise D is supposed to be a dove gray, which is like a bluish gray, and this particular paint was the closest I could find to it. What I'm doing now is I'm thinning out the paint with some of that 91% rubbing alcohol, as was suggested on a couple different sites. So it's supposed to be 50%. So I think I did 15 drops of the paint, so I'll do 15 drops of the alcohol. After I got thinning it, I stirred it up real good. And now it was time to put it into the airbrush. The great thing about doing voiceovers on your videos after you've already shot the footage is you get to sound cool, confident, and calm. I was none of those things. I have never, ever used an airbrush on a final model piece. And I had a look of terror on my face, and I was pretty much like a triple standing next to a Klingon. Okay, so I went at it, trying to get the control down, and it was kind of fun. Actually, it was a lot of fun. I've been wanting to try airbrushing for a while. I just need to get my skill set down. All right, we got two things accomplished. We got the flush vents all painted. I just got to set them aside to dry, and we learned how to airbrush. All right, so we'll move on to the next mod, which would be the darkening of those windows for the hull. So here's the piece of plastic that is going to light up the windows on the deck too. Eagle Moss has already blacked out some of the windows, as you can tell by these little squares. Now I did a test over here on the left side. That's why there's a big blob there. And that's what we're going to do to each one of those windows where the black is at. We're just going to extend the black around that so no light can leak up and make that weird kind of lighted frame around a dark window. As you're doing this, you want to be very careful not to get that black near the unpainted windows, or else you're going to black them out. So just go slow and steady. And here it is all finished. Those windows should be nice and blacked out now. So that's all the mods for stage one. Now let's start putting it together. And I guess we need the directions right here. Stage one parts, stage two parts, stage one assembly. Main bridge module 01D, and slot it into place on the top of the bridge base. Secure with two pieces from underneath using two AP screws. Okay, so we'll take this, put this away. Okay, so this is the first piece. This is the 01D, and slot into place on the top of the bridge. Oh, this is 01C, and 01D is this piece, which if you watched our modification video, this is where we put in the bridge dome. And one of the things I noticed right off the bat with this modification we did, which I didn't read about, is there's no way for the light to shine up into here. So we're going to have to correct that. We're going to do some on-the-fly modifications. Is we have to drill, make a hole underneath the piece we added so the light can come up. I'm going to put a little mark there so we can get started.
Ouch! It was poison.
Well, an injury. That went through really easy. Alright, and I'm going to put this into place. Okay, that's perfect. So that's going to allow that light to come through. Okay, so now we can get started. And we're supposed to drill them with two AP screws. Yeah, these are going right in. Okay, that's done. It was step A, step B, take the bridge lights. 01V marked with a C sticker. So we're going to dive right into doing some wiring here. Okay, take the bridge lights, 01 marked C sticker, and identify the bulb with the yellow-white wiring. Okay. Fit this bulb into the underside of the bridge base, 01C is shown, so the parts immediately below the bulb
surround the oblong jut. Get that out of the way. Oh, and that's how the top dome light gets lit up, because this lights the top and the bottom. It does it perfect. Okay, next, cover the bulb with the bridge rear window. Bridge rear window. Right here. Now take the other bulb from the bridge lights with the red-black wire, fit this to the underside of the bridge base the same way as the first bulb. There's nothing really to hold it into place. Oh, there's a tiny little nibbly bit right there. I got it. This slides up into.
I don't know if you can see it or not.
Cover the bulb with the bridge front. Thread the wires coming from your bridge assembly through the center of the bridge bottom 01K. Then place the assembly into the bridge bottom. So this is the bridge bottom.
Right here.
And try not to let my fingers up on these two pieces here. Okay, the bulbs and everything are in there. Okay, now I'm hoping these get held in with something. Okay, two more AP screws. Again, we're going plastic to plastic, so there's no need for the lubricating oil. Step E. Locate deck 2.
That's this, and this is where we painted the vent ports,
or the umbilical connections, rather. And the emergency flush vent, fit the vent into the slot as shown. Then take the deck lights, OU1 marked with a B sticker, and fit the bulb with the black and yellow wiring next to the vent so that the rubbery base of the bulb straddles the oblong joint. We're going to follow all the directions on here, except mounting the light, because there is going to be no light on there. So locate the two deck and the emergency flush vent. Fit the vent into the slot as shown, then take the deck, mark with the yellow next to the rubbery. Use the emergency flush vent left bracket to cover the bulb and fix.
Okay, so
this goes here. This goes here. Now, there's supposed to be a bulb that goes in here, but we are not going to be
putting a bulb. I'm off frame again. I'm sorry, guys. But we're not going to be doing that. So we're just going to mount this without attaching the bulb.
And that gets held in place with a CM screw. All right, this is going into metal. So I'm just going to take some of our Rapid Tap. And that's another CM screw.
Okay, so there we go. The two flush vents are in.
Turn it this way. Insert the deck front window 01E into the access at the front underside of the two decks.
Okay, so this, if you recognize from, if you followed along with the mods, this is where we added in a few more. We did a little more blacking out, so we made sure that they definitely didn't show. There was no light leaks on them. So we put that in there. Next, cover the deck front windows with the deck front window deflector 01F. Then slot the bulbs from the deck front lights marked with A sticker into both ends of the front window deflector as shown. So the deflector is this part which reflects the light. We need wiring harness A, which I know I had, which is right here, A. Okay. So there's a little tiny piece of plastic standing up right there that keeps them in place. So again, we're going to have to be a little ambidextrous here. I'll put this one here. I've got to pull these apart, it looks like. Now, the directions don't tell you whether the whether the red and black lead, getting AC mixed with DC, goes in the left or right, but it does tell you in the pictures, so that's why I'm doing it this way. And I'm actually going to, what holds these in here? A CM screw. Now I'm just going to put one in here lightly to hold this light in here. And that's going to allow me to slide this light in. Perfect. Yeah. Love when a plan comes together. Hey, wouldn't that be a neat Eagle Moss, the A-Team fan? I'm putting in the last of the four. Making sure they're all secure. Because you want these tight so there's no light leaks. Alright, so that's into place. There's the two lights. What's next? Step G. So turn deck to upright and position the upper sensor platform 01B in the central Ovid space. So it wants me to take this piece and fit it into here. Secure it from underneath with four AP screws. Hey, that's all screwed in. Take the bridge assembly that we did earlier from step three, insert it into the center of the deck two, threading the wire from the bridge through the oval gap in the center of deck two. Align the three screw holes and fasten with CP screws. So there you go. Again, there's that hole for the dome. We'll put it later that we made. Carefully remove the six escape pod covers from their sprues and push them into place on the exterior of the deck as shown. Somebody's already made a mod for this. Let me get my flush cutters. Somebody has already made a mod for these. You can relabel the covers. Supposedly it's more realistic than what they have here. And these are just press fit and they stay in there. Okay.
and the pins on the back. Matching with the hole. That South Jersey accent is making the word hole, H-U-L-L, sound like hole, H-O-L-E. Okay, so those are the escape pods. They are in. That was step H. And that is it for stage one. Here we have the bridge deck, deck two. And let's see if... There you go. So this was the hull. And if you can see, there's our dome we put in there. Come on, Steve. There you go. So we did all the lights. We did the flush vents. We've got the red ports on the side. So that concludes the stage one build of the Enterprise 1701D by Eagle Moss. Stage two will be coming out in a couple days with the mods, so take a look for that video. I hope you enjoyed watching this video as much as I did making it. Maybe it'll give you some hints and maybe it'll encourage you to do your own builds. Eagle Moss has a lot of different varieties of models, and I really encourage you to take a look. The links for everything that I used, including paints and tools and supplies and even Eagle Moss, will be down below. So if you found this video helpful, hit the like button. Be sure to hit subscribe if you want to see more, and really hit the bell if you want to be alerted to when the videos come out. So till next time, I'm Steve, and thanks for stopping by the Maker's Cave.